सब्सक्राइब करिए शॉर्ट एंड डिक्टेशन चैनल को और दबाइए इस बेल आइकन को ताकि आपको मिले लेटेस्ट अपडेट्स। बी रेडी, 5 seconds, स्टार्ट। मिस्टर स्पीकर सर, परमिट मी एट द वेरी आउटसेट टू एक्सप्रेस माई डीप एप्रिसिएशन एंड gratitude for the contributions made by the honorable members from all sides of the house. They were very critical and at the same time an incisive look into our foreign policy will undoubtedly contribute in the formulation of the policy in future as it had contributed in the past. We look with great attention to what this house says. Sir, may I immediately advert to an aspect that appears to me to have been a fundamental aspect that has emerged from this discussion. That aspect is that while the international scene has undergone changes and indeed radical changes, there had been a tradition in this country for 4 decades or so, the tradition of a consensus approach to the foreign policy, the tradition of a national consensus backing our foreign policy. I see that tradition today, I saw it the other day, and I saw it throughout this debate, the national consensus on foreign policy, in spite of the radical changes that have taken place in the world, the national consensus on the Indian foreign policy reflected in this parliament, which undoubtedly reflects the country as a whole, that national consensus is here and it was shown by all sections of the house, and that is indeed the most heartening aspect that has emerged from this debate. We are with the opposition, we are with all sections of the house when they say that the new international scenario does indeed provide an opportunity, and we need the opportunity and the opportunity of the democratization of the international order should not be lost. This is the time when real democracy in international relations, justice and equality must prevail and can prevail, and large and small countries, powerful and not so powerful countries may and can be treated on the footing of equality. Let us march together, big and small, powerful and not so powerful, rich and poor. Let us march together in the new era of international relations. In the spirit of fraternity of the international community, it is possible that this can be done, and therefore we are with you, we are with the opposition, and we are with all sections of the house, irrespective of their political fold and irrespective of their party affiliation, when we speak of democracy of the international order. We are also with the house and the opposition when we speak about democratization of the most important instrument of the international order, of international operation, that is democratization of the United Nations organization itself. Of course, in the context of democratization of the UN, questions such as expansion of the Security Council, which is supreme, as it were the executive organ of the United Nations, is important. But no less important, as has been pointed out on more than one occasion, over the last couple of days is the question of having an international order which addresses itself to regional local problems or otherwise in a non-selective manner, in a manner that is based on the international legality and in a manner which cuts across the globe and deals with situations on merit and law, as I have said, on well-established principles of justice and equity. Sir, the debate has established this consensus and indeed this unanimity of views on the relevance of the non-aligned movement. The non-aligned movement was never predicated on the Cold War or on the confrontation between the superpowers. The premise on which the non-aligned movement lies, and indeed the raison d'etre for the non-aligned movement, is the need of those countries which had recently acquired independence to preserve their political independence and to strengthen their economic independence. We see today the need for the non-aligned movement to continue because we see today the need for the non-aligned movement to fulfill its unfinished task, if I may say so, because the agenda remains unfinished in many fundamental aspects. The question of disarmament, the question of development, the question of environment, and not the least of all, the question of economic and social progress and prosperity. As we see it today, the end of the East-West confrontation and the new collaborative relationship between the two superpowers or the two former superpowers, and indeed the era of collaborative relationship that has now arisen among all the great powers, is very much welcomed by itself. But then we must be alert to the danger of a sharper North-South divide in the absence of corrective action. In our view, the South should not be marginalized in the international fora when major political and economic decisions are made. Therefore, it is in this context of what I have said that the non-aligned movement, the principles of non-aligned movement, the raison d'etre of non-aligned movement continues, and the need for non-aligned movement to be as strong and as effective as before still remains.